In this video, we're given a projectile launched on a level surface with a known velocity, and we're trying to find the flight time and the range and the maximum height for the projectile. So the way we start things out is by just breaking that initial velocity into components, which is actually part A of the question. So I normally do as much as I can up here in the diagram, and I'm going to break that velocity vector into a horizontal piece that I could call Vx, and a vertical piece that I call Vy. And that horizontal piece is given by the adjacent leg of the right triangle when we break this vector into components. So that's given by the hypotenuse, 45 meters per second, multiplied by the cosine of the angle, cosine 38. When I run the numbers on this, I get 35.5 meters per second for the horizontal component of velocity. Now the Vy we're looking at is actually the opposite leg of the right triangle, the vertical component of that original velocity vector, but it's been translated to the initial position of the object, which you're free to do with vectors. They're totally movable. And the magnitude then is the same as the opposite leg of that right triangle, so 45 sine 38. And when I run the numbers on this, I get 27.7 meters per second. So there's the answers to part A. In part B, I want the flight time. And the key to deciding how to approach this is looking at the landing of the object and asking, what extra bit of information do I have there? And for projectile motion problems, that's either going to be a known final x coordinate or a known final y coordinate. And in this case, it's a known final y coordinate of 0. So I'm going to approach this by using the y analysis of the problem. So the y coordinate as a function of time here is given by the first kinematics equation. And for projectile motion, the acceleration in the vertical direction is downward and has a magnitude of g, or 9.8 meters per second squared. I'm going to go ahead and plug in my initial y value. That was 0. And my final y value, that's also 0. And my initial y velocity, that's 27.7 meters per second. And my acceleration, that's negative 9.8. So I'm going to pull the minus sign out in front. And then half of 9.8 is 4.9 t squared. Now this is a quadratic equation, but we don't require the quadratic formula. And I can solve this quadratic equation simply by factoring. I pull a t out. And there's two solutions to this equation. The easy one is that t is equal to 0 solves this equation. And the harder one is found by setting this other factor equal to 0. So when that factor is equal to 0, the equation is also true there, because 0 times anything is 0. So setting 27.7 minus 4.9 t equal to 0, I can then add 4.9 t to both sides and then divide both sides by 4.9 and I get t. So that's 27.7 over 4.9. And I get that t is equal to 5.65 seconds. Now we got two answers out of this, but we only care about one of them. And to understand why the extraneous solution was produced, I go back to what I was telling the mathematics here. I was really just telling the equations. Y is equal to 0. Tell me what time it is. And there's two different times where this is true. It's the starting point and the finishing point. Now clearly it's the finishing point we're interested in. So t equals 0 is our extraneous solution. And our flight time is 5.65 seconds. Once you have the flight time, you can get the range very quickly. I just look at the x equation of motion for the projectile. Again, that's just the first kinematics equation. But then I plug in this information about projectile motion. There's no forces acting horizontally, so the x acceleration is always 0 for projectile motion. And this first kinematics equation reduces to basically distance equals rate times time. I'm going to go ahead and plug in the fact that my origin was at the launch position as well. And now it really looks like distance equals rate times time. So I want to get the final x position. And I would normally call that r. And that's going to be the initial x velocity, which was 35.5 meters per second, times the flight time. That's how long it's been moving rightward that fast, 5.65 seconds. And rounding to 3 sig figs, I get 201 meters for this. Finally, I want to get the maximum height for the projectile. And there's two basic approaches to this. Because of the symmetry of the problem, because the landing height is the same as the launch height, I can say this projectile reaches its maximum height at half the flight time exactly. Just keep in mind that approach is not going to work unless you have this high degree of symmetry. If the landing height was higher or lower than the launch height, the maximum height would no longer occur at half the flight time. So rather than show that method, I'm going to show the more general method, which is to say that at the maximum height, that's the transition between a positive Vy and a negative Vy. And right at that transition point, you're crossing over from a positive number to a negative number. Vy must be zero at the maximum height. And this is the general approach to getting maximum heights in free fall problems and projectile motion problems. You say Vy equals zero, and then you ask, what's the height at that point in time? Again, we have options here. I could use the fact that Vy is equal to zero and find out what time it is, and then plug that time into the height equation. Or I could get more clever about it and look for another kinematics formula that doesn't involve time, and that's this one. Again, these formulas are all valid as long as the acceleration is constant, which it is in the y direction for projectile motion, is constantly negative 9.8. All right, so this offers me a bit of a shortcut. I can plug in that Vy is equal to zero, and I'm going to ask, what's the y coordinate at that moment in time? My initial y coordinate, also zero. So plugging in the numbers here, I get zero equals V0y squared, that's 27.7 squared, minus, because I'm going to plug in a equals negative 9.8, 2 times 9.8 times my final y coordinate. And now I just have to isolate that y. So I'm going to add this term to both sides of the equation and then divide by twice 9.8. So I type in 27.7 squared divided by parentheses twice 9.8. And rounding to 3 sig figs, I get a y value of 39.1 meters. Just to be extra thorough here, I'll go ahead and use the half the flight time method as well and just make sure that that the answer agrees. And again, this only works because I have a high degree of symmetry in this problem. What I'm saying is, because I have this perfectly symmetric trajectory, the highest point should happen at half the flight time. And I'm going to call that T max. Half the flight time is 2.83 seconds. And then I plug into the vertical equation of motion, and I find out what's the y coordinate when t is equal to 2.83 seconds. Again, my initial y value is zero, and my acceleration is negative 9.8 meters per second squared. So I plug in V naught, that's 27.7 in the y direction, times t, minus 1/2 times 9.8, times t squared, 2.83 squared. And when I run the numbers on this, I get 39.1 meters, just giving us a double check on our work. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.